And so this is an ICB conference, and ICB itself is 10 years old this year. So ICB has been on the scene. How many of you had heard of ICB before this event? Okay, a few, probably less than a third of the people in the room. So I'm glad to have you here so you can understand the collaborative nature that ICB employs in working with the 37 private HBCUs that comprise the UNCF network. And ICB has historically worked in a number of areas to help our institutions build capacity, specifically around the primary areas have been in accreditation support. So we have a program that's been around for years called FASTAP, and I'm going to try to remember this acronym, Fiscal and Strategic Technical Assistance Program. And so we've provided a lot of accreditation support. We've provided a lot of institutional advancement support. Where's Claflin University? I know that Claflin, I talked with Leroy Durant earlier. Oh, okay. So the Claflin folks are back there. And actually, Claflin has laddered up significantly their institutional advancement program, primarily, and you, if when Dr. Tisdale is here tomorrow, he will also tell you that a significant part of that effort was $1 million capacity grant that was given to Claflin through ICB for its institutional advancement program about 8 years ago. And so ICB has played a significant role in helping to build capacity for our member institutions. And this is the third of, in the last 3 years, we've done these kinds of knowledge management and professional development institutes. So a few years ago, we did one on cohort default rates. Last year, we had an institute for our chief financial officers. And this year, we've tackled the area of enrollment management. And so our goal is to bring to you best practices and tools and skills and knowledge that can help you do your job more effectively, that can help you also build and sustain a strong and robust pipeline of students to our member institutions. I was looking, we do this report through Patterson that we send to our member institutions every couple of years called the Statistical Report. It's not a public report, but we do a lot of data analysis of our institutions compared to all HBCUs, compared to all privates and all institutions. And one of the things that we found, a trend that has continued, is that over the since about 2000, applications at our member institutions and HBCUs overall have increased substantially. So you're getting a whole lot more apps. Does that sound consistent? People shaking their heads, nodding their heads, yes. And you're admitting more students as well. However, the problem is the yield. Over the last, since 2000, the yield has been basically, the number of students has been flat in yield, percentage of students has been flat in yield, but actually the yield percentage, the percentage of yield has actually decreased substantially. In 2000, on average, at our member institutions, we were yielding about one out of every three students that you admitted. Now the yield is down to 18%. And so this is a challenge that ICB wants to help our institutions address. And so hopefully over the next, our plan, hope, our president and CEO often says, hope is not a strategy. So our plan is to give you with tools and equip you with the information and tools that you need to stem this tide of diminishing yield and build up the robust pipeline of students to our member institutions. So with that, I encourage you to learn as much as possible, listen, engage. We've got people engaged in Twitter. We've got a UNC, I don't know if I'm stealing some of Sherry's thunder, but we've got UNCF, ICB has an account. So we're encouraging people to tweet as much as possible. If you want to tweet me, I'm happy with that too. My handle is at B Bridges PhD, but at UNCF ICB is something that we want you, is the handle that we want you to also tweet about as well. So we want you to learn, engage, collaborate, learn from each other because there are best practice models at our institutions as well as some of the presenters that you will listen to over the next day and a half or so. So more than anything else, we want you to have a good time, but learn and go back to your campuses fully immersed with some new knowledge that will help strengthen the work that you do on a day-to-day basis. So with that being said, I will turn things over back to Dr. Turner, who will lead us to the next steps. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bridges. At this point, I want to acknowledge the various folks who have had a significant role in making this event happen. Of course, you've met Dr. Bridges, who is my boss with UNCF, but there are a number of other individuals who have worked diligently to ensure that this event was successful. I would like to acknowledge someone who is probably not in the room. That person is Ms. Daryl Ann Watkins. If you have, she's actually out at the registration desk, but if you have received information about this either through email, phone calls, reminder calls, if you needed assistance with travel arrangements, speaker arrangements, what have you, Daryl Ann Watkins is the person who managed that process flawlessly and effortlessly. Yes, absolutely a wonderful person. She will be our new senior program manager. That's a secret, but I'm sure that's just between the folks in the room. But we're very pleased with the work that she has done. Also, I would like to acknowledge Mr. or Dr. Joseph Montgomery. Joe Montgomery, would you stand? Did he sneak out? Okay, here he is. Much of the early work, the envisioning, the identification of experts and of leaders in the field, the planning process, much of that was done by Joe Montgomery, who's now with the College Board, but formerly he is the Vice President for Enrollment Management at Voorhees College. Am I correct?
No, just Director of Admissions.
Director of Admissions. I gave you a promotion. But we are so thankful for his wisdom and expertise and the work that he has done ensuring that we bring to you the right blend of information. There are other members of the Institute for Capacity Building team that I would like to acknowledge. Mr. Ed Smith Lewis is here to my right. You may know him through the work that he is doing with Career Pathways Initiative. They just recently had a major convening. But we know that that is a program that will have a tremendous impact on not just HBCUs, but PWIs, predominantly white institutions, in ensuring that students who graduate have successful futures and that they are well prepared. Isidra McGlone is another member of our team who is probably not in the room, but if you see her, please let her know how much you appreciate her as well. The program that we have planned for you over the next few days will be extremely rich. We have put together a program that will provide you or equip you with technical tools for thinking about the work that you do. We will provide for you strategies for ensuring that your enrollment management and your retention and recruitment plans are solid. We will provide you with perspectives. We have a panel that will be designed to help you to hear or gain insight on what are some of the things that keep your presidents up at night. And then we also have a panel which will be designed to give you some insight into what goes into the thought processes of students, of college admissions counselors, of high school guidance counselors, parents, and others. So we want you to come away, again, informed, but also inspired to do the work that you do on your campuses. We realize that for enrollment professionals, that this is a very critical time of the year. I imagine that not many of you are vacationing during the summer, is that correct? Because you are busy bringing in your class, and we know that, again, this is very busy time for you, but we're just very thankful that you have chosen to be here. Before we begin our opening session, what I want to do is to take just a few minutes to get to know you all a little bit better. We want you to spend time networking and building your relationships with colleagues in the field. And so what I'd like to do is take a few minutes just to allow your food to digest. We're going to give you an opportunity to stretch, but we're going to lay a foundation for the networking that you're going to do. And so we're just going to do a little bit of an icebreaker. And what's very simple, I'm going to make some statements. And if this is a statement that applies to you, I simply want you to stand up and then sit back down, and we will do this. And I want you, as we go through this exercise, to look around the room to find or identify persons that you might want to connect with over the course of these days, okay? So, the first thing I'd like is, if you are a graduate of an HBCU, would you please stand? Wonderful. Okay, sit back down. Okay. If you are a graduate of one of UNCF's member schools, would you stand? Wonderful. Okay, have a seat. If you are currently working at your alma mater, would you please stand? Interesting. Remain standing if you have only worked at your alma mater. Wow, okay. Interesting. If you are an admissions professional, would you please stand? Okay. Okay. If you are a financial aid professional, would you stand? If you are a registrar or someone who deals specifically with registration and records, would you stand? Okay. Excellent. If you are a college president, would you stand? Or former president? Okay. If you have ever received a UNCF scholarship or internship, would you please stand? Wonderful. Okay. If you are a UNCF staff member, would you stand? If you feel that you are overworked and underpaid, would you please stand? Okay. If you feel that you are underworked and overpaid, would you stand? Okay. If you yourself were a first generation college student, would you stand? Wonderful. If you plan to tweet about your experience at the Enrollment Management Institute, would you stand? Okay, wonderful, okay. And if final, last question, if you have found or identified at least two people that you want to connect with that you don't know before, did not know before, that you want to connect with before this institute is over, would you stand? Fabulous, fabulous, wonderful. Well, our goal again is to make sure that when you leave this event, that you are well equipped, but also inspired and well connected. And so we trust that this will be a great experience for you. With that, I would like us to transition to our opening session with Ms. Arlene Cash, who is in the back of the room. And we're going to set aside, do you need a few moments to get connected, Arlene?
Yes, I do.
Okay, we're going to, okay. We're going to take just a couple of minutes to get connected. Okay. Well, while you're getting connected, I'm going to ask just a couple more questions. If you've been in your current position for 10 years or longer, would you stand? Or raise your hand. If you've been in your current position for less than 1 year, please stand. We hope that you will assist us in making sure that the programs that we offer are most successful and most relevant to your needs. At the end of every session, you will be given evaluation forms to complete. Please help us by submitting those and turning them in. We will be offering wonderful prizes for those of you who do so. And I believe that there are tickets that you will receive once you turn in your evaluation forms. And at the end, we will be able to provide some wonderful incentives for you.
Looks good. Well, thank you, everyone. It's awesome to be here today. It's great. I appreciate the invitation to be able to talk to you a little bit about enrollment management. And this is a very interesting process of trying to get more students to want to know more about us. It's called, as we all know, the inquiry stage. If you think about enrollment management and the funnel for enrollment management, I often think about it as relationship or like the dating process. So first you have all those prospects, and that's all of us, the possible people in the world who might even kind of want to date you or know you or get to know you better. And at some point or another, you connect with those prospects, and some of them say, well, maybe you might be my type, and so I'll just ask you to send me a little bit more information about you, make sure you're the right size, shape, weight, you know, have the right background and all that, and you become an inquiry. How do you move those inquiries to be actual applications? Someone who you really take out on a date, who you may spend some money on for dinner, or you may spend some time with after dinner and during dinner and all that. But we're going to talk today about getting to know you well enough to want you to date us. How do you get more students to become inquiries? What motivates you? What motivates them? What incentivizes them? What encourages them to move on to become inquiries? My name is Arlene Wesley Cash. I've been doing enrollment management in one form or another in some capacity at some institution or another for the last 40 years. I am a first generation college student, a proud alumna of the Upward Bound program, and a proud also former employee at an HBCU. I'm currently at Guilford College in North Carolina, but staying very connected with my sisters and brothers and friends at many of the HBCUs, not only in North Carolina, but actually around the country. So today we're going to talk about prospective student motivation, influences and incentivizers for enrolling students through the inquiry stage. So we'll talk about the challenges we're addressing, how to communicate to win, relationship building, search done better, and multiple personas, how we can handle it. And then hopefully we'll have some questions and interaction among ourselves. I really feel like almost all of you certainly all of you collectively have way more experience than me. Most of you have more and better experience than me. So hopefully you'll bring some of your expertise to this presentation as well. When we think about the environment we're in now, we look at some things like the changing demographics. All of you have heard about the witchy data, more students of color. Some states will be predominantly minority students. affordability, the issue of students having less and less money to spend, colleges and universities having to charge more and more just to keep the doors open, just to keep some of us paid minimally, just to keep food in the cafeteria and the residence halls open. But the value proposition as well. Why would you choose this school? What makes this school better than others, and how do we go about the process of helping students see why our institution, whatever institution is yours, is the one they should attend? Most school students, about how many schools are students applying to these days? Just throw it out there.
Eight to 12.
This is Mr. College Board talking about it now, okay. Cheek, you know all the stuff. Okay, it is 8 to 12. So it's 8 and 12. I ran into a student at my school, and I bet you have students as well. I had a student at my school who applied to 37 colleges and universities, and he got into two. So mine was not one of them. So I guess you have to throw the dice out there, the buckshot or whatever, and you do your best to get in. But there are some students who get into all of them, and then the process doesn't get better just because they apply to more. But our job, I think a lot of our job, is to help them see why our school, it makes most sense to narrow it down to 3 or 4, maybe 5, and let our school, whatever school you're at, be the one to which they should apply. Redefinition of our peers. 20 years ago, we knew who our peers were. We were clear who our peers were. There was no question. We knew that we overlapped with these 5 or 6, 8 schools, and those were our peer schools. Now you can have peers all over the place. In the slide later on, I'm going to show you a surprise peer that came up for me this year, a surprise school where I had over 20 students apply and get in along with my school. So you just never know where they're going to show up and which ones they'll be. And then alternative degree programs. When we talk about inquiries, what are they inquiring for? Are they inquiring to be just regular bachelor's degree students? Are they transfer students? Do you have certificate programs on your campus? Are there places where students can go to grad schools? What about students who want to take non-degree? Students who only want to do adult or evening or weekend or fast-track programs? So all kinds of different kinds of ways you can apply and get into school. How are we connecting our resources and our institutions with the ever-changing needs of the ever-changing student population? So I'm going to spend just a couple of seconds talking about those changing demographics. So we know that several states, according to the WICHE data, will have majority-minority students and their states. Georgia is one of them. Arizona, Florida, Nevada, Maryland, Virginia, D.C., Mississippi, New Mexico, and Texas. So these schools, by 2020, according to WICHE, will have majority-minority student populations, which means that a lot of the students that we felt at HBCUs were pretty much coming to our schools are going to have lots of other opportunities. Also, though, we're going to have lots more opportunities to recruit them. So if these states are not on your radar, maybe they should be on your radar, because when they graduate from high school, they're going to be looking at places which are comfortable, where they'll feel supported and affirmed, where they'll feel like they're not just a guest, but they're actual members and owners of that community. And that's how I look at many of the HBCUs where I've worked and consulted and been around. These are places where students of color, students with a disadvantaged and underserved, will feel like this is a great place for me to be. Affordability is another issue, and tuition, as we know, has to increase. So we hear a lot. I know all of us hear reading the papers all the time. Why is tuition so much? Why are y'all charging so much for tuition? Is it really worth it? Well, bills have to be paid. Water has to be paid. Electricity has to be paid. I have to be paid. My secretary has to be paid. President got to be paid. Cleaning people have to be paid. Grounds have to be mowed. You know, windows have to be washed. Stuff has to happen, and people are not doing it for free. Anybody here want to do it for free? Volunteer for the next 3 years. Come on now, somebody. Nobody. Okay. Tuition's going to have to go up because it costs more. It costs more every day, not just for us as individuals, but the electric company doesn't want to hear about students are having a hard time affording. They're saying electricity will go up next year. Here's your new price to use the same amount of electricity. We have to be able to pay that. So the option is not charging less tuition. We just have to increase tuition. Most of our schools are cost less than their peers and their PWI peers in their states and their communities, so we're already charging less usually, and our students are less able, for the most part, to afford what we're charging. family incomes are not increasing at the same rate as tuition's increasing. So we have a challenge in matching that up. There's that malalignment or that misalignment of the tuition going up, family incomes not going up, at least not commensurate to the level of the tuition going up, and the cost of the students incurred to go to college. And then we have the economic conundrum, and enrollment is often called upon to bring the fix. Who's going to fix the problem? How many of you have above a 70% dependence on tuition? Probably almost all of you. Most of us do. Y'all don't, so that's great, awesome. So many of us have tuition dependent. If we didn't bring in the tuition, lights do not go on. A lot of colleges in that situation. So if they're going to have to deal with an increase in tuition, and you have to bring in, if you're not having to increase it more than you want to, you just have to increase the number of students that you're not only enrolling, but that you're keeping there, new and returning students. And so you have to have the value proposition. This picture was on a magazine. I was in the store one day, and Consumer Reports, it was that last month, I don't know if you saw it, the front cover of Consumer Reports had that picture on it, and it said, I regret going to college. You see it? That's scary to me. I don't want anybody to see that, okay? I want everybody to feel, yay, I'm going to college. In June, I want students, because they still might not come to college. So I want students and parents to feel that they should be coming to college. When you look at Consumer Reports, those kinds of scare tactics have been scaring students from student debt. They're scaring students away from being able to pay and be able to afford to come to four-year colleges. And it's a challenge for us to meet that. So we have to figure out, is college worth it? Probably so. If we look at this in general, the enhanced income, if nothing else, is worth it. But also, as a person, as a community, bringing in more college graduates makes it worth it. But what about for my college specifically? How is it worth it to go to my college? Why should I pay $40,000 to go to my, why should someone pay $40,000 to go to my college versus $35,000 to go to some other college or $45,000 to go to the other college? So not only finding out is college worth it, but helping that inquirer know that it's worth it to come to my particular school. And so we all have new peers and new measures and new ways to measure who our peers are. Who were your peers, your competitors 20 years ago? So where I am, I just put up my peer competitors. I got Guilford Technical Community College, Greensboro, Winston-Salem State, North Carolina A&T, University of North Carolina, Greensboro, and then what in the world? The Aggies. The Aggies from New Mexico. Okay, so we had New Mexico State University showing up, 20 students who applied to Guilford College in Greensboro, North Carolina, also applied to University of New Mexico State University. What in the world? We didn't even visit New Mexico, okay? So you never know who your competitors are. You never know who's going to have you on their radar. And you have to be ready for whatever it is. You need to be ready to understand the whys of it. So how has that changed over the last 20 years for you? What are you doing for peer analysis, and when can you compare one year to another and one peer to another? How do you stand up with your peers and to your peers? I said earlier about alternative degree programs, certificate programs, early college programs, five, six, seven, eight-year connecting programs, whether you're getting an associate's to a bachelor's, 2 years, bachelor's to a master's to a law degree, all kind of programs. Reverse enrollment with community colleges, students who are coming back to college, who started the community colleges, and they want to come to your school to get a bachelor's, but they haven't finished their associate's degree. Or they don't want to stay at the community college, and they want to come straight to your four-year, but the community college is hesitant to let them go. So how about developing a program that allows a student to continue getting credit for their associate's degree, transferring it back and getting that associate's degree at that community college, and using that credit towards a degree at your school as well? All kinds of different ways in which you can connect students to a degree program they want. Evening programs, fast track programs, Saturday programs, 3-credit programs, come in all day Saturday, all day Sunday, seven weeks in the semester or 5 weeks, and work on towards getting your degree. And commuter versus residential programs. So what kind of programs do you have that really meets the different needs of the students? Interestingly, when we talk about traditional students, they're 18 years old coming to college, right? But that's not your standard average student. Average student is over the age of 32. The average student is married or is independent or has a child or is non-traditional in all kinds of ways. 3/4 of students in college are not the traditional 18 to 21-year-old going to college anymore. So being able to understand the process of finding, making them inquiries and addressing their needs as well is very important. If we're going to grow, if we're going to be bigger and better and serve more students and serve the student of the 21st century, we've got to be more flexible. We've got to be more flexible and when we offer courses, which courses we're offering, how often we offer them, and how we structure our degree programs. Those are the kind of things that make students who are not traditionally looking at your school, and those are students who are going to the for-profit and proprietary schools, because they are addressing those kinds of needs of the students. And when we look at the demographics of those schools, those are African-American people, older, most of them older, coming back to college or starting college at a later age, that could be and should be on our campuses, on your campuses at some point or another. I don't know if a lot of you, any of you sort of familiar with the, Franklin Covey's the 7 habits, but one of them is first understand and then be understood. And one of the problems we often have in looking at students is that we don't take enough time to understand where they are. So these students today, and I'm going to go straight to the 18-year-olds, the young students coming into college straight out of high school. If you don't know who they are, if you don't get them in some kind of way, they could care less about you. They're going to pass any and all of us over. So we have got to first understand how to understand them. And then, after that happens, they will start listening to us, and they'll start paying attention, and they'll start responding to us. But it is complicated. They are complicated. They don't know what they want to major in. They'll change their major 3 times between when they apply to your school and when they actually show up at the front door. And so you've got them in your system as a biology major, and they're mad at you because you don't know that in their brains, they've changed to English. How did you not read that brain for them? How did you not read that mind? They think we are reading their minds, okay? But they have placed clues out there. When they visit your website, if you're tracking or doing your Google Analytics, you may see that that student all of a sudden is visiting the creative writing program, even though she's in there as a biology major. Or she's looking up the information from a professor or looking at the YouTube of students who are in the English programs. So being able to track students and track them and their traffic on your website is going to be very important for you being able to communicate with them very well and move them from the person who is thinking about your school to the student person who actually applies to your school. But they really expect you to know a lot about them. We're no longer dealing with the millennials. Now, the millennials, they were born between 75 and 95, and now we have the Gen Zs, and they are very different. The Gen Zs are digital natives. They never knew a world without computers and access to electronics and all that. The millennials, they're digital learners. They learned how to use it. They taught us as their parents how to use it. They communicate with images. And so they're doing that Snapchat. Yes, thank you. Is that the ghosty guy? Yeah, they're doing Snapchat. But the millennials, they were texting. They wanted to communicate through texting. So the millennials, the Gen Zs, they don't want us on their Snapchats. They don't want us anywhere near it. When we, as the older people go there, they move away quickly, as you probably know. They create things. They like to make stuff. They like to make things happen, and they like to make things. They like to have their hands on it. They want to create their path to success. They will access support, but they want to create it, as opposed to sharing things. So you know, we always talk about the oversharing of these kids. Everything's on Facebook, and I mean everything, on their Facebook page or on their websites or whatever they have for the millennials. Gen Zs, they are creating stuff, and so they're the ones who are doing the videos. I'm not gonna forget the name of it, but anyway, they have the little videos where you can just walk around and take videos. They're also walking around catching Pokeballs. Yeah, they're doing that too. But adults are doing that also, so you know, so that's really one of those things. The technology is really all across. In fact, there was a group down in the lobby when I got in today. I guess there's some pokey people down there that they can capture. So you never know where you're gonna find them. They're future-focused. Those Gen Zs are future-focused. They're looking to the future. They're saying, what's next? What am I going to do? How am I going to get there? What is it going to take to be there? Because they saw their parents laid off and not have jobs. They saw their cousins and aunts and grandparents lose their homes. They saw struggle. They saw strife. They saw people that they depended on and loved and cared about really uncertain about tomorrow. And so they are very focused on making sure tomorrow is taken care of. And that means they do not want to do what? Take out a loan, okay? Because they know that if they take out a loan today, what do they have to do tomorrow? Pay it back. They know it because they've seen their loved ones lose things because they could not pay it back because they were in horrible loan situations, primarily with their homes. And so they are very focused no matter what their income is, no matter what their background, they are really serious about not having to take out a loan if possible. And so communicating to them at the inquiry stage that this investment, this loan as an investment is critical to their future success, making sure they see ahead of time as inquiries that if you go to college, particularly if you go to my college, you will end up with a career, more than likely, don't want to promise anything you really can't give, but more than likely you'll have a career that will allow you to make more than you would have in the past and allow you to pay it back. Or if you want to go into a field where you're giving back to society, where you're helping out mankind, and you don't make but $27,000, $30,000 a year, you can also have your loan deferred, and after a certain amount of time, you won't have to pay it back if it's a federal loan. So helping them understand not just that they have to invest themselves or the families have to invest in their college education, but helping them understand that there are options for them. They are future-focused, so let's not be shy about saying what happens in the future. Yes, you will graduate, number one. No matter what your graduation rate at your school is, if we can convince every student that they will graduate, that really gives them a head start on actually graduating, okay? So tell them, you will graduate, and when you graduate, you are gonna make more money than you would have with just a high school degree. And doing that will put you in a better position to get a job that will either help you pay back your loan or get a job where that's fulfilling, and you'll have to pay your loan back incrementally. But helping them lay out the plan, begin with the end in mind. Tell them what's going to happen 5, 10 years after they start looking at your school. Very, very important. The millennials were present focused. I don't know if any of you, my kids grew up with Barney the Purple Dinosaur. Barney had a special song when something like this. I love you, you love me. We're a happy family. With a great big kiss and a hug from you and me, you know, won't you say you love me too? You are special. You're the only one. You're the only one like you. There is no one in the whole wide world who can do the things you do. Imagine your TV babysitter told you every day, and sometimes twice a day, that you're the only one who can do what you do. That makes you feel pretty present and special, doesn't it? And it's not quite the reality of things. Lots of people can do lots of things. But that's what the millennials are, and that's why they expected rewards all the time. That's why they expected to be affirmed all the time. They got those medals and trophies for showing up for the soccer games. Gen Zs, they want to know the end of the year, what's going to happen at the end of the year, where am I going and why am I going there. Very future focused. And they're realists. They get they understand that life is not a bowl of cherries, that stuff happens. They've watched stuff happen in their life, in their world. And the millennials, they're optimists. They think everything should happen and will happen well. They work for success. Now, a lot of people complain about the millennials and talk about, I have two millennials and a Gen Z. And I will say there are distinct differences between the two older ones and that younger one. They really are. And I'm always surprised because I don't believe in any of these Gen Z, millennial, Gen X kind of things, particularly as it relates to students of color, because I think that we have a different kind of perspective and coming from a different place from which they do this research. On the other hand, when I look at this and I look at my children, I will say that young David, he wants to work. David, of my three sons, David really feels as though if he works hard, he will succeed. My other two, can you please discover the greatness in me? If I just sit here, will it become evident to you how wonderful I am? I don't want to want to say, yeah, no, get a job. Okay, graduate. So that's my boys. Anyway, the Gen Zs, they really are a different group, and I think that we'll enjoy working with them. And I think that when they come into our classrooms and in our colleges, they really want to work and be successful. They are the ones who will show up with a B and look for the tutor to get the A. They are the ones that will want to be an RA or help out in some kind of way so that they don't have to take out the extra loans. So you're going to see they're a little different. Now, the first question is, we are no longer dealing with the millennials. But on this one, you see, or are we? Because if a person's born 1975 and in the year 2000, they could be a parent, right? And in 2016, little Bobby Joe is wanting to come to your college. And he's the son of a millennial. All these factors you're going to be dealing with all over again. So get ready. Just because you're not dealing with the millennials anymore in your classrooms does not mean you won't be dealing with millennials anymore. And who is the greatest influencer of students to where they're going to go to college?
Parents.
Mom specifically, okay? Mom is a millennial. So mom, she is a digital learner. She's not as bad as me, but she is just getting used to digital. So don't ask her to go online and have to do a lot of forms. She's able to, but she'd really rather you do it for her. She communicates via text, and she wants immediate. She's an ATM person, okay? I put it in, I want it out right away. I want immediate gratification. My son is showing up for orientation. Can I please have 4 years of his registration right now in front of me right now? They want to share too much. Bobby Joe, well, you know, he special. He might, you know, you might need to put him in a single because he just needs to be alone. He's used to having that at home, you know, so. And she's not leaving the office until Bobby Joe gets it, so. We've dealt with millennial parents. They're present focused and they're optimistic. They think all their children are going to be successful when they graduate, when they get into college, and they want to be discovered. They want you to know how great they are and then how great their children are. So, we got the Gen Zs, and we got the millennial parents, and we're just in for a big party in the next 10 years or so. So enjoy that, buckle up, get ready. Promote your values. So another part of this whole kind of thing of getting more increased interested and incentivized for your school is really understanding who you are and helping students and their parents know who you are and what's the value of your school. So the quality of the learning experience, why is it better to go to your school, supportive environment, student-faculty interaction. These are just things that almost any HBCU, almost everyone I've ever worked with can say these three things, that we have an excellent learning experience, that we work closely with our students, that they are not just students, but they're not quite our children, but we do talk about family. Don't we talk about family a lot at HBCUs? We talk about our Spelman family, our Morehouse, our Howard family. We talk about them as members of our family in many kinds of ways because we do care for them more than we care, more than just in our roles as whatever, the registrar or the admissions director. We care for them as individuals, and we take care of them. And that's one big reason why many parents, even parents who went to PWIs will choose to send their child to an HBCU. And then the student-faculty interaction, of course, critical. And outcomes. You know, how do you talk about the outcomes of your school? How do you talk about what's going to happen when my child graduates? What's going to happen the first year they come out of college? I mean, the first year in college. So do you want to see your child coming home and at the end of the first year summer, binge watching Netflix or playing video games or something? No. You want to know that child is going to be doing something productive toward their career. So when we're communicating at the inquiry stage, we've got to be talking about what's going to happen all along. If you don't have a mapping process for your school, I would suggest you really think hard about having some kind of way you can show on a map the progress, the student development progress a student will make. If you can't do it individually for each student, try and do it in some kind of way that is generic, but it can be personalized. So the person, you can ask, you know, do you want to study abroad? Okay, boom, here's what that will happen. Do you want to do an internship? You want to be a doctor? Okay, well, here's three kind of internships you probably should do if you're interested in being a doctor. Help them and connect them with other people on the campus. who are part of this map creation. Because once again, if these students, they are future oriented. If they can see the end, they will see a reason to begin with you. Many schools are not doing this, and so you will be ahead of most if you begin as an inquiry to show them, here's the process to you being a graduate and a successful graduate from this institution. But you've got to lay it out for them. They will take it and they will run with it, but you've got to find a way to get it in their hands. And if you're hot, if you think your school's great, if you think your school's awesome, you really have to put it out there and say why. And this is not a time to be shy or humble or anything about your school. If you're hot, show it. Make sure people know it. Act like it. Do what you have to do, okay? Show the very best of your schools all the time, but particularly in the point where they're inquiring and trying to think of where they're going to go. Now, I know all of you have heard of these of stealth inquiries, and these are students who are out there just looking at, just sort of randomly through your website, picking up brochures, just looking at you and not telling you they're interested. So consider every single thing that's on the internet about your school as an inquiry piece. Someone's looking at that thing, that website, that posting, that tweet, Twitter realm of communication. They're looking at all of that, and they're deciding, is this a place where I want to spend the next 4 years of my life, and why? And be sure to communicate in their language. I dare you, tell me what all those stand for. I got some of them figured out, but some of them I have no idea. So, you have all kinds of communicate, all kinds of languages. Every single thing here has a purpose, and it means that something that they use it for. And you have to know which one to use for what. So when do you Skype someone? When do you use Facebook? When do you don't? When should you use Facebook? When would you Pinterest? When would you do? I don't know what else is on here. Apple, whatever that's for. So using each of these appropriately is very important to them. So I'm going to ask you, what is your social media IQ? Which do you use when and what for? So if you're using Snapchat, what would you use? What do you think students use Snapchat for? Say it loud. A little quick video, okay. But what? So what's the little quick video supposed to say? Why? Self what? Self-promotion, absolutely. So the little Snapchat is to say, here I am, here's what I'm doing right now. Now, I'm not fully versed on Snapchat. Is this the one that goes away after a little bit of time? Yes? Okay, so not only here I am, here's what I'm doing, but in a minute, that's gonna be gone. So enjoy this now for this moment. They like Snapchat. It's one of the biggest social media right now for African American females. So just know that Snapchat's out there. If you're having an event on campus, if you're having an open house, if you're doing a tour, give them the little ghosty thing. Tell them to Snapchat a little bit of their tour. Snapchat their conversation with somebody. Snapchat the trees on your yard, whatever. Encourage them to Snapchat so that they're interacting with it, therefore they're interacting with their peers. When they go back, their friends are gonna say, oh, I saw that you were at XYZ college. How was it? That's the kind of question you want them to encourage to answer, because now their friends are helping you recruit them. How about Twitter? What do you use Twitter for? I have the answers right here, so I can just say. So Twitter is used for announcements. So, when students are tweeting something, they're announcing it. At Bennett College, awesome chapel. Howard, the Mecca, whatever. So they're doing they're tweeting little notes to say, here's an announcement about me. Here's an announcement. You can use Twitter to say, if you have an open house program or something, or a program where you have students on campus, you can ask students to be on your Twitter site, and then you can tweet things like, ice cream on the quad in 20 minutes. They didn't know it wasn't scheduled, but let them know that. So they find ways in which you can tweet for your students while they're there. And I have what I call regular, how many of you have student ambassadors or tour guides on your campus? Y'all don't have any tour guides on your campus? You do? Okay, thank you. How many of you have electronic tour guides or electronic ambassadors? So think about having electronic media ambassadors. people that you hire who tweet, who do Snapchat, who are doing things connecting with students every day. Students that, of course, that you trust, but students who are really communicating in the language, using the medium that students, that these prospective students want you to use. And then Facebook. First of all, they could care less about Facebook anymore. You know, it's not very popular, except that we think it's not, but it really is. 78% of students are using Facebook on Facebook every day for at least 90 minutes a day. 78% of 18 to 12 to 20 year olds are on Facebook every day for at least 90 minutes a day. So I think we should not give up on Facebook. And what do they use that for? They use it to build community. They're assessing the culture, they're making, doing roommate matching, they're getting to know their class better, getting to know the students at your school better, and each other better. So Facebook is still very much used by them. When we think about using electronic media, though, we have to always also understand that everybody doesn't have access like we think they do. 97% of students have a cell phone, but not everyone has a smartphone. And everyone who has a smartphone does not have unlimited data. I would venture to say that most people who have a smartphone will not have unlimited data. So what you ask of them to do on their smartphones is very important, that it be something worth the data. Because if they use it up, their mom or their dad or their grandma or whoever is going to be distressed about it and going to tell them they have to, you know, have to not use it anymore because they used up all their data. It happens in my house at least once a month with somebody is using up too much data. So I imagine that we have to be sensitive to that. Also, though, older African Americans use smartphones less than anyone at all. Over 60 years old, they're less likely, I think it was 30% or less than 30% are using smartphones as a means by which they communicate and get information. So students who are living with their grandparents, if you think that they're going home and using their smartphone or they have a laptop at home that they're using to access your information, you are wrong, wrong, wrong. They are not. And parents and grandparents and guardians are really key players in our inquiry development. So thinking about that, think about how you're communicating and using different means of communicating. Also, low income access to high speed broadband at home. So this is from a Pew study 2014, but it's still very relevant that there's not a lot of high band access in the homes and communities of low income individuals. It's just not. And so asking them to, you know, go to your website and fill out forms or go to your website and look at tours online or whatever because they can't visit, it's not going to happen as much as we would like it to happen. So just being sensitive to that is very important. Not only being sensitive in our expectations, but being sensitive in our asking. Because when we ask them to do it and they can't, that's a negative feeling they're having about us as well. So just being sensitive to that. So relationships are very important. If you're going to be trying, if you're going to put together a program or a series or of communications to increase your inquiry on return, relationships are critical. So you want to keep it personal, and don't give up connecting with them. Even if they don't respond, don't give up. Your admissions people, your financial aid people, your academic affairs people, stop looking at them as counselors and begin thinking about them as coaches, okay? As people who know them well enough to say, I'm encouraging you. Go, Johnny, go. You can do this. Your future's ahead of you. Your future is with us, through us, as one of us. Being a coach, as opposed to just a counselor, will give the student a sense of you really caring about their future. And that will make a difference in them deciding, will you be a school to which I shall apply on or not? So, you know, when you're sending them something, don't just send them a little letter. Put a little lunch ticket in there to encourage them. Do something to encourage them to come and visit. 20% discount in the bookstore. It's unlikely. We give out thousands and thousands and thousands of 20% discounts. We may get 3 or 5 back a year. Even students who come don't bring the discount card with them. But they love getting it. They love you saying, I want to invest in you to the level of giving you a discount. And if you come and visit my bookstore, we will give you a discount for something. And just because they don't respond doesn't mean that they don't hear you. It doesn't mean that they are not listening to you, that they're not hearing what you're saying, not seeing your publications or your presentations. They're just not responding. They don't think they need to respond. The point is to give them information. You've given them information, right? Enough said. They have what they have what they want. They're not worried about responding, so you know that they have what they want. And if you have an idea of the major when they're on campus, don't just, if you know that they're an English major, make sure they go to the building where English is taught. Make sure they look into a classroom, maybe where a teacher is teaching English class. Make sure you're connecting them in as many ways as possible to who they are and what they want specifically. And add a handwritten note to typed correspondence. As we all know, any kind of personalization, the first thing a student will read on a letter is the PS or something that's handwritten. So you might, if you can do it, it's great to be able to do it. We have in our office, after a student applies for financial aid, they'll get a little handwritten note from their admissions counselor, the admissions coach, just saying that they're glad they're applying for aid, and that hopefully we can help you out with financial aid. I'm here to help you with it. It's just a small note, four or five sentences, but it really does, students really do feel well connected to that. Longmire is just a company that does a lot of research, and they did one on relationships. And they say, we're constantly on building a relationship. All the time, know more information, use more information, keep that information on some kind of data. If you have a CRM or something, keep it so that you can see, here's who talked to Johnny last, here's what they said, here's the promises we made, here's the promises we fulfilled, here's what Johnny wants, here's where they're going next year, here's the changes that were made. The more you know, the better the relationship. Explore every facet of the student's performance, of their preference. They like green, they like Jell-O, they like whatever, dogs, cats. If you know their preferences, know it and share that. So when you send a communication with them, you can reference that. Access the impact of programs, communications, and visit. Make sure that you're measuring. You have research. You have surveys after all of your programs, so you know what's working, what's not. Make sure you have a specific parent recruiting track, remembering that parents don't always have access to electronics like students do. They're not as comfortable with them as students are. But having some means by which you're connected with parents consistently over that period when they're an inquiry. And then getting personal. And be prepared to answer all kinds of questions. If you can't answer yourself, make sure that you know someone, you're able to say, let me find someone who can't answer that question, because they want to know if they're going to come to your school, that they're going to be taken care of in every single possible way. So when I think about relationships, as I said earlier, I think that we have to really look at this in a very personal way. So for this next little piece, I would like you to not think of this in the original way in which it was presented to some of you who may have seen this before, okay? But think about this in terms of students and connecting with students. The point is, I was going to play the song which had the lyrics, but I won't go there. The point of it is, find 100 ways. Who knows the words of that song? I know somebody must know the words. Find 100 ways to say you love them, okay? If it's diamonds she wants, if it's a star she wants, figure out how you're going to get that star and figure out how you're going to help them get what they need and find out what they need about your school. So anyway, you get the point. Be clear, don't be late. When you're communicating with students, when you're connecting with them, make sure that your messages are very clear and consistent, and don't be late in responding to them. Here's what we know. The timely responses work. If you have a purpose to each communication, plan an initial response email no later than 24 hours after the inquiry. Do you know how many students you lose waiting more than a day? Just 24 hours. Some of the research says that you will lose 60% of your inquiries, 60% after 24 hours. And the first one they hear from, if you're at a college fair or a campus visit, the first one they hear from, that person wins over you. So whatever way you can do it, find a way in which you can communicate with them right away, soon as possible, after they've made an inquiry. Response time matters. Like I said, likelihood of qualifying an inquiry is 60 times less after the first 24 hours. This is from a Harvard Business Review article. multimedia, they want to connect with them in all kinds of ways, have all kinds of messages available to them, and don't give up. Just because you're not hearing from them, send the birthday card. Send the Mother's Day card to the mom. Send the Father's Day card to the father. Say congratulations when they graduate. Send them tweets, email them, phone them, send postcards, congratulate them, greet them, have a birthday greeting or some kind of greeting for them. Use mail, use phones, use emails. The more multimedia you use, the more different venues you use to connect with them, the better, and the more likely it is that they are going to respond in some kind of way. And what's our role in them meeting their goals? What is our role in them meeting their goals? Not much, okay? They want to map out their own education. They are the architect of their education. We are here to help them build it, as far as they're concerned. So we have to provide the roadmap and let them drive along. Show them how to draw the draft. They want to know what GPA do I need to get in? Make sure you give them that information. How do I get a job when I graduate? Lay this out for them ahead of time so they can see that it's possible through your school. How will you help me afford to be here? How many emails do you think they get in a day? How many emails do you think a student gets when they're a high school junior going to the senior year? I'm going to say a lot. Would you say a lot? Okay. How many of them do you think they open? Not too many. Right. Okay, so the subject line has to hit home, and it has to hit home immediately. Use videos, not long videos, 15 to 30 second videos. Use short videos just to get quick messages across to them. I think you can do that through Snapchat. Make the content personalized with more than my first name. If you're just saying, "Dear Arlene," blah, 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 generic, that's just generic to them overall. You have to say, "Dear Arlene, how long has it been since you lived in Boston? Oh, great. Well, I hope you're enjoying North Carolina. Tell Mrs. McGillicuddy, your English teacher, I said hello. I was there 2 years ago." They think you know everything about them, so know as much as possible and let them know you know it. What is your open rate on mail you send to their home? Does anyone know the open rate of mail sent to people's homes? You don't know, do you? How do we know that? They communicate with images and they like to create things. How can your envelope help? So maybe you have an exciting, wonderful, creative envelope that will help them open it. Anything you can think of that will help them open it. But guess what? Why have an envelope? Because when I send things to people's homes, guess who I'm really sending it to? The parents, right? It's for the parents. And so parents are unlikely to open something with their child's name on it, but they are all about reading something that's open already, okay? So I send things that they can look at right away. They don't have to open it. Because really, I want them to see the great things that are going on. Once again, not just a counselor, but a coach. Oh, I'm sorry, this is a repeat of that one. Who's in the driver's seat? So maybe they're not that young in the driver's seat, but in the enrollment stream today, students are driving the search process. They're dropping in and out at their own convenience and leisure. The 3-1 rule, okay? The 3-1 rule is this. Every 3 things you say about a student, you get to say 1 thing about yourself. Okay? When you're communicating with a student, it's all about them. Don't forget that, okay? It's all about them, okay? Don't tell them about yourself. Tell them about themselves. Emails, letters, websites, you only get to say how great you are once. For every 3 times, you say how great they are. If I had more time, I would ask 2 friends to come up here, and one of them would say 3 things great about the, why am I a good friend? 3 reasons why I'm a good friend, about me, 1 about the other person. And the other person would say one-on-one, 1 good thing about myself, 1 good thing about you as a friend. And when I've done this with groups all the time, the more appealing conversation comes the person saying 3 things about their friend, about why they're a good friend, and then 1 thing about themselves. That's the same thing with students. When you're talking to them, when you're giving presentations, I tell my president all the time, when she speaks to the students, 3 things about them. You are great, you are smart, you are beautiful. What's that? Remember that? You is smart. You is beautiful. 3 things about themselves. 1 thing about you. Okay? I tell all the time, you gotta go there. You can't be about us all the time. It's stream spanning. Okay, so when you have an inquiry, communications plan, 6 launches. You have to have at least 6 things that you're doing. Have a calendar. First, I'm going to send this. The second thing doesn't require any response from the first thing, but have six things, because at the end, they're just hearing it and they're seeing it. And the more they see it, the more likely they're going to get to know you, and the more likely they will eventually respond. And provide a 360-degree experience. Be everywhere your audience is and know who your audience is. If they like mail, if you see that they're responding to your mail, then mail them. If you see that they're actually sending stuff back to you, go ahead and use the mail or email or Twitter or any of those other kinds of things. But be aware of it and chronicle it so you know for each student what they're doing. And think about the different personas, okay? Every persona needs its own communication flow whenever possible, and they should follow in print as well as digital communication. So here's three churches. One, this is a church, place of worship. This is place of worship, and this is a place of worship. All three very different, right? So when you're talking to someone who's in each of these, you're not going to give the Baptist conversation to the people in this church, are you? I don't think you should. I mean, you could, but I don't think you should. Okay? You're not going to give the synagogue conversation, this is the Baptist church, stop, to the people in this church. Every church, every persona deserves its own communication flow. And you can develop personas. If you can't do it for every person, develop profiles of groups of your students and have different communication plans for them. Engage them using multiple channels, encourage engagement, explain as much as respond. So not just saying thank you, but explaining why it's great that they responded. Creative tailored to the students themselves are searching. Present your brand and message in ways that the research and experience indicate is best. Use your research. And still, some students will not respond, and it's okay. Do not be discouraged. They are hearing you. I promise you, they are hearing you. More of the right names. When you're buying search and you're trying to develop your inquiry pool, 17% of the enrollees come from searches of less than 60% well-selected names. But 49% of enrollees, if you have more than 100,000 names, are well-selected names. If you have that, a big school. Be sure to use analytics to select the right names, search volume and quality together. And volume alone does not always mean more enrollees. It's quality. It's the kind of students who will do well at your school. Non-enrollers, okay, once again, this is the admissions person waiting for a response. Not to worry, okay? They're thinking about you. Don't be distressed about it. And then you have the stealth applicants. They're out there looking at you. They're out there collecting information. They don't want you to see them. They don't want you to respond to them. They're kicking you off. They're unfriending you. That's okay. They're out there. If you have good information, if it's relevant information, if it's revealing about you, it'll be fine. And then once again, multi-channel, using different kinds of things. Time after time, we've seen multi-channel search, email, mail, and phone. It yields more when you use different medium because for a while, you don't know what students want. So use email, use mail. Use your phone, call them. I know I have 1 minute left. Five whole minutes. She said one. Okay. Research what names to purchase. Purchase names strategically from various providers. Communicate with prospective students often, well, clearly, transparently. Analyze for future campaigns what's working, what's not working. The definition of madness is what? Keep doing the same thing and expect different results, okay? If you see something's not working, stop doing it. No need to do that anymore, okay? Do something different. Think differently. You may fail twice. That beats failing once the same way over and over, okay? And then building a database and inquiry pool based on design rather than chance. You're creating a class. Use your research to do predictive modeling. We all know about prospective student surveys, strategic enrollment goals identified. Know what if you want more students from Georgia, spend time in Georgia. Well, you're in Georgia. How about Boston? If you want more students from Boston, spend time in Massachusetts. Okay, spend time emailing them and writing them. Use your alumni there. Use your current students there. And then purchase names to build your inquiry pool. I'm sorry. Oops. So this just asks you when you're using data, what do you use? I mean, last time you made a big decision, what kind of data did you use? Did you use consultants, your own intuition? You see, 30% of people use the intuition because intuition is a good data source, actually. A lot of intuition comes from your experience and your intuitive analysis in the best computer in the world of your experiences. Don't ignore your intuition, okay? It is important, and you're making decisions, and often it's right. Without data, you are just another person with an opinion. Have some data. If you want to support getting more money for your programs, use the data. I have appreciate your time and attention. What keeps you up at night? What keeps you, what makes you, you know, worry about things? What kind of inquiry development? If you have questions, I could answer them, but I have a feeling that I'm out of time, so I will say thank you very much.